Hello. Today I talk about my research on uncertainty quantification for community detection. This is joint work with Bas Klein, and in this video I will explain what we are doing. So community detection is a very important phenomena. Often in a network, some nodes in the graph are more densely connected, and they indicate some important function. They are often relatively independent of each other. For instance, in the yeast protein interaction network, communities are cellular entities that perform certain biological functions, which are relatively independent of each other, in this study of Chen and Yuhan. Well, often the stochastic block model is used for community detection. Well, in the stochastic block model, a graph with n vertices, where each vertex I belongs to a community theta I. And they are connected with probability Pn when they belong to the same community, and with probability Qn when they belong to a different community. Now, and then you observe the graph and you want to reconstruct theta, which is a known. Well, what is the current state of research? The classes are approximately of equal size, and that's also something we cannot get rid of. The number of classes is assumed to be known, and that's is an assumption that we will relax. And now, for instance, in this study by Kheng, Bhattacharya, and Patty, they allow the unknown number of classes to be two or three. And in here in Zhang and Zhu, the number of classes is assumed to be known, but maybe even as large as n over log n. Well, what are our contributions? We allow an unknown number of classes, which might be as large as n to the power alpha. For some alpha smaller than a half, which gives also an answer to the open question in ABBE: is exact recovery possible in classes of sublinear size? Yes, in dense case, classes of size n to the power 1 minus alpha. We treat uncertainty quantification with confidence sets and hypothesis testing, and we give explicit upper bounds on the errors for all n. Well, let L be the number of classes, which is upper bounded by this capital Ln, and Mi the number of classes with label I, and that had to satisfy this bound. So we also require that that the number of elements in one class is approximately n over L. And we consider the following prior. So we first put a prior on all possible number of classes, and then given the number of classes, a uniform prior on all allowed labels. Well, the posterior distribution is of course given by the Bayes formula, and questions that we may ask: does the posterior concentrate at the true parameter? Can we convert credible sets into confidence sets? And can we test for the number of communities? Well, we have to distinguish between several sparsity modes. So we have the dense phase where the average degree is proportional to n. So we have this bounds, and we also consider the Chernoff-Hellinger phase where the average degree grows logarithmically. So you can connect with n minus 1 neighbors. So that gives rise to the average degree that's logarithmically. Or the Kesten-Stegum phase where the average degree is bounded. And well, the posterior, the convergence depends mostly on the Hellinger affinity between two Bernoulli distributions, which is given by this formula. Well, in the dense phase, when Bn is the log of the Hellinger affinity, and Ln is satisfies this bound, and when this is satisfied, then the posterior concentrates around the true number of classes. And if in addition this holds, then we have posterior concentration in one point. Well, the proof consists of two steps. First, you prove that the posterior chooses the right number of classes, and in within the parameter space theta and L0, it concentrates all its mass in the true parameter. Well, let's give an outline of the proof. We use the likelihood ratio test for testing between two parameters theta and eta. And the number of pairs ij, so that theta I is theta j and eta I is not equal to eta j or vice versa, determines the strength of the test. And we use the size of the cluster to build tests for testing between the number of classes so that you have a uniform lower bound on Bn. And then we use the paper by Bas Klein from which accepted for the annals of statistics to get a posterior convergence in the right parameter class. And then within this class, we use the Hamming distance to give a lower bound on Bn, basically very similar. Only the combinatorics is a bit different. Well, then we have some special cases. So the Chernoff-Hellinger phase, then if this bound is satisfied, we have convergence like this. So the convergence is a bit slower. And in the Kesten-Stegum phase, we don't get convergence into one point. We instead need a small ball around the true parameter, which counts the fraction of misspecified labels. And then we also get convergence in this small ball. So what we obtained is that we allow the number of clusters to be unknown and grow with n, and we have explicit bounds for every n. And this so these explicit bounds allow us to obtain results for credible sets and Bayesian testing with posterior odds. Well, let's talk about confidence of credible sets. So a credible set is a set that it has, for instance, 1 minus alpha n credible mass. And when we also have posterior convergence in the true parameter, then and we have with this probability, which mostly depends on the rate of convergence, that the true parameter is in the credible set. And what is the outline of the proof that's given here? So you have the confidence set. So this is the parameter set. And you have the credible set, which has posterior mass at least 1 minus alpha. And then you have the true parameter. But because the posterior concentrates in the true parameter, then with an event of high probability, this has more than alpha posterior mass, which means that the true parameter is in the credible set because the posterior mass of the whole parameter set is 1. So if it's more, if this is more than alpha, it must be in this set, because otherwise there must well be more than one. And well, confidence set in the sparse case. So in the sparse case, we don't have convergence in one parameter. So we have to make our treadable set larger in order to guarantee that it's a confidence set. So we allow all parameters that are a fraction, that have a fraction of their labels different from a parameter in the credible set. And then if we have posterior convergence in this set with this rate, then we have that the posterior is of that with this probability the true parameter is in this enlarged credible set. Well, what's the idea? The idea is very similar. So you have your credible set, and then you have your ball where the posterior concentrates in. So eventually, on an event with high probability, the posterior mass of this ball is bigger than alpha, so they cannot be disjoint. So if you make them larger, then the true parameter must be in this set. Then we also treated hypothesis testing with posterior odds. So if you want to test whether your true parameter is in a set AN or in a set BN, and those two are disjoint, well, we can use posterior odds. So the posterior mass of BN divided by the posterior mass of AN. Well, if the true hypothesis, if the null hypothesis is true, then it's expected that the posterior mass around AN is big and around BN is small. So this FN will be small, and vice versa. If the alternative hypothesis is true, then the posterior will put a lot of mass in BN and less in AN. And so this will be big. So we reject H0, so this is a typo, so reject H0 when Fn is bigger than Rn. And well, we have bounds for that as well. So when the posterior concentrates in An on average, then we have this bounds. Well, what's the proof for this? So we have that Fn is this. So because An has more than 1 minus alpha n posterior mass on in expectation, it follows that because they are disjoint, that this is smaller than An. So this event An, you can prove that this has so that the posterior mass around in An is at least half, has a probability at least 1 minus 2 an. So the probability that fn is bigger than rn is bounded by this. And then with the Markov inequality, this is smaller than this. Yeah, so this was everything I wanted to tell. You can read the paper with on archive. And you can always send me an email if you have questions. Thank you.